Amistad and Harper Audio present Things Past Telling, a novel by Sheila Williams, performed by Robin Miles. This book is dedicated to the grandmothers. Blessed are they who remember. They was things past telling, but I got the scars on my old body to show to this day. A seed worse than what happened to me. Mary Reynolds, formerly enslaved, Black River, Louisiana, WPA narrative, interviewed in Dallas, Texas, 1937. Mrs. Reynolds' age, approximately 100 years. In the before time. It is important to remember that at the beginning of the 19th century, the vast majority of Black people, slave and free, did not reside in the Black Belt, grow cotton, or subscribe to Christianity. Ira Berlin, Many Thousands Gone, The First Two Centuries of Slavery in North America, 1998. Daughter of a strange God. For Judah hath profaned the holiness of the Lord which he loved, and hath married the daughter of a strange God. Malachi, chapter 2, verse 11, King James Version. Wise woman. I have one child who is buried in Kentucky, and that grave is pleasant to think of. I've got another that is sold nobody knows where, and that I can never bear to think of. Lewis Hayden, quoted in Charles L. Blockson, The Underground Railroad, First-Person Narratives of Escapes to Freedom in the North, 1987. Mama Grace. If you meet a woman of whatever complexion, who sails her life with strength and grace and assurance, talk to her. What you will find is that there has been a suffering, that at some time, she has left herself for hanging dead. Senna Jeta Nasland, Ahab's Wife, 1999. History is what's left after the lies are taken out. Part 1. In the Before Time. 1. Liberty Township, Highland County, Ohio. May, 1870. I sit in the sun. Old bones like the sun. Nicholas say, Mama Grace, you're gonna fry up to a crisp you keep on setting there. I tell him, let me fry. The sun feel good. Only thing takes the ache in my joints away is its warmth. It spreads across the backs of my hands like butter. Francis whips out of the door, marching over to where I sit. Oh, Lordy, that woman. Moves so fast like she a soldier on a march. Mama Grace, you didn't eat your breakfast. You gonna waste away you don't eat. She frowns. I can't see her too good. But I know Fanny, and I know she frowning. Shame to mess up a pretty face like that. But her worry is out of love. Not much hungry, Fanny, I tell her. Old as I am, I'm wasting away anyhow. I chuckle. I like that little joke. Nicholas grumbles. No sense of humor in that boy. Mama Grace, you need to eat. I shake my head, rub my knees. Oh, that sun do feel good on my bones. Put me into mind of a story I heard. Long time gone now. Whose story that? About Zekiel, out in the desert. Think that where he was. With bones, dry. He connect them. Dry bones. Zekiel, he... I did wonder what that boy doing out the middle of nowhere with... Mama Grace! I do eat, Nicky. Just enough. He and Fanny eye each other. I feel it.
I know what they're thinking. What can you do with this woman? Set in her mind. And her mind wandering. I smiled to myself, leaned back on the little pillow calico made up for my chair. Feel like I'm on a feather bed sitting up. That gal of mine is a wonder. She can make anything, do anything. How I get such a child? The sun warm. I think I'll just take me a Admiral bark like his head gonna come off. Somebody coming. That fool dog. Nothing that hound like more than work his mouth. Then he growl. Oh, somebody white coming. I do not know why Nikki trained that animal to growl only at white folks. Well, yes I do. Nikki used the same name for all his dogs. This only the fourth, fifth. Anyway, that hound comes from a long line of dogs named Admiral, and they all was taught to bark at white folks. Can't see this man, Will. Better wait till he get closer up. I can hear his voice. Oh, now he coming closer. Nikki must have grabbed Admiral's collar. My one eye good, but the other one, I see only shadows. Just voices. Words going back and forth. But not conversation. This is business, I tell by the tone. What's he saying? What's the family name? How many are you? And who are you? A census taker man. I remember the one came through afore the war years, decades ago. This Ohio good about counting up his people. That man could not get his head wrapped around me and the children. Seemed to him I had one colored child and one white one, and he was trying to figure how that happened. I told him to look in any field at the cow and bull. Better than that, ask your mama. This man's voice is high and thin. Reedy like. Reminds me of the Kentuckian. His voice used to hit my ear all wrong, too. Sent a chill down my back. Well, he gone now. Nikki speaks. His voice deep and booming. The voice he uses for white folk. Polite, but not deferential. He wasn't raised to be deferential. I chuckle again. At least Nikki is trying to be polite. Fanny? I feel her simmering. Just imagine her face, skin pulled close to her cheekbones, her dark eyes about to skewer that man. That girl has a short fuse. She's done with this nonsense already, I can hear it. I see the numerator now. He nothing out of the ordinary. Just another white man dressed in brown and gray clothes. The man licks his finger and turns to the next page. There's a breeze, and it catches the paper and plays with it. As head of household, Nicholas answered the man, just like his mother taught him. Always answer polite, like you were raised. But that's all. You're a free man, just like him. Calico has told him this since he could talk. Good thing he listened to her. I've answered many white men in years and years, too. Some polite-like, and some not.
There's me, Nicholas. I'm 45. Where are you from?
The white man interrupts. I hear Fanny take her breath. She's standing just behind me, so I can't see her face. But I know it looks like thunder about to roar.
Oh, how?
The man writes deliberately, forming each letter as if he were just learning it.
Color?
What kind of question is that?
Mulatto,
my grandson answers.
What kind of answer is that? He's not just light, that's all.
He marks off the other family one by one. The man is riding furiously, trying to keep up.
My wife, Frances, about 42 years old from Virginia, she's mulatto. Our oldest Samuel is out on his own. Then there's Shelton. He's out at work. Apprenticed.
I hear the pride in his voice. The world turned round on those boys. Shelton's training to be a blacksmith.
But Nikki will have to be careful. Pride is something white folks don't like to hear from us. Your wife from old Virginia? The man asks. Is there a new one? Yes, but all of our children were born here in Ohio. In my head, I hear my grandson say, and all of us are mulatto except Ezekiel. He connected them dry bones. I close my eyes and let the sun warm my eyelids. Sun, warmth. I remember there was a place where I was warm every day and liked to feel the sun on my skin. Now I feel the numerator's stare. He has to count me too, but I know what he's thinking. He's thinking I'm no count, and I don't talk much anymore. Already said most of what I came to this earth to say to the people I wanted to say it to. My grandson answers for me. She's my grandma. Mariam, Priscilla, Grace, P-R. I know how to spell it. The man barks. I feel Fanny's fingers dig into my shoulder. Hold your temper, gal.
How old is she? She looks old.
112. Born in 1758. Or 68, I'm not certain. Neither is she. She is pretty old. At least 90.
Can't you ask her?
Nicky tells the man that I don't talk much. A few moments pass, and I know that he's making a gesture that means I'm a little squirrely in the head now. Not that he believes it. He just does that so that folks leave me alone. I decide to snore a little bit. Behind me, Fanny snorts. Mama Grace, she's blind, Nicky continues. Maybe, but I do see.
And where is she from?
Virginia. My backbone twitch. No, I'm not. But I'm speaking only to myself. But yes, I am from Virginia. Lived there many years. But no, I'm not. Not from there. That Virginia is like Ohio. Home, but not home. Only my lives there, and the lives I lost, made it familiar. The crops I planted, the babies I helped into the world, the earth where seeds and sins. Virginia is familiar, and I know it, but it's not where I'm from. Fanny interrupts.
Excuse me, sir, but do you want to know where Mama Grace is from or where she was born?
I hear that pride again. Fanny can read and write and figure. She teaches school. She a force, Fanny is.
Does it matter? The man asks.
He sounds annoyed. And I know. I can feel what he thinks of me. I know what he sees. An older-than-time colored woman of unreliable sight and no value, probably invalid and not worth 2 cents, much less $1,500, what Nash got when he sold me to McCulloch. He clears his throat.
Officially,
he tells Fanny.
It says, birthplace.
All right, then,
she says, minding not to unsettle the man by sounding too grand.
Mama Grace was born in Africa.
The word strikes me in the face, as if Fanny had slapped me. I near stood up. Africa. I never heard that word until I came here. And since then, I've been from so many other places, names strange to me, living lives that I've near forgotten, but won't. Can't. Tennessee, a stop. Old Virginia. They say there's another one now. Jamaica. I remember the smell of it. I remember the first place I stood on hard earth after days at sea. That wide, beautiful, dark, horrible, deadly sea where bones float along the waves and the finned fish follow. The key looks so much like South Carolina and that island where the Igbos walked into the sea. Norfolk. And now this here, this Ohio and a swollen, fast-running, dirt-brown river. I've been so many places to be from, and then there, the place that Francis said, Africa. Not what I remembered it called. A peculiar word, hard to form the sound with my mouth. Not what I called it by when I was there in the before time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.